Hello, I'm Darian.
I'm Aria.
And you are watching Night School, a live program where we bring together scientists, artists, and creators, truly some of Earth's most interesting people, to dig into a new theme. And tonight, it's bedtime. We're talking all about ecological beds found along the California coast, deep underground, or at the bottom of rivers. So, like, definitely not the ones you sleep on unless you're like a frog or something. I'm so excited to introduce you to our amazing guests. But first, sorry, Arya, there's something on my screen. Do you see that?
Yeah, that's the QR code.
You mean the one that links to the survey that'll help us to learn more about some of our favorite people on Earth, the Night School audience, so that we can continue to develop and grow this program with them in mind?
Yeah, the QR code.
Well, intrepid Night School viewers, if you would like to share a little bit about yourself with us, please use that QR code or the link that we're currently putting in the chat or the comments. All responses will be kept totally confidential and will help us to continue making Night School as high quality a program as possible. We're looking forward to knowing our audience just as much as we are looking forward to knowing a bit more about our guests, though. Aria, who do we have the privilege of meeting tonight?
Tonight, we are starting off with the Academy's own co-director of community science, Alison Young, as she shows us all about her work with mussels. Mussels are these little animals that might remind you of clams. They go like this. And the California coast is home to lots of them. So many that they grow in these big clumps and patches to form, say it with me, mussel beds.
Mussel beds.
Mussel beds. We'll talk about how these amazing little bivalves can create habitat for tons of other tide pool critters. And if you're a regular Night School watcher, Allison has been around before on some city nature related episodes that are definitely worth checking out again.
And then after Allison from the ocean, we're tracing it back inland to rivers. Current Fulbright researcher Dr. Catherine Russell studies riverbeds. In particular, she very recently published a study about how plastic pollution can change how rivers ebb and flow by impacting how riverbed sand is transported. Rivers weave through a huge range of natural landscapes, but that does include humans and our cities. And I'm very excited to tap into Catherine's wealth of knowledge about how humans and rivers change one another.
And then for the last one, we are digging deep, at least deep enough until we hit bedrock, the solid stuff that's beneath the loose soil at the Earth's surface. And Kara Pryor is going to show us some gorgeous bedrock geology maps that she made using cross stitch. Plot twist. She will share about this longstanding art form and about her process of translating scientific data into these very colorful and shareable patterns that can help us understand and connect with our natural environments better. And if you were looking for a sign to pick up fiber art as a side hobby, a side hustle, a thing you do once and then forget on your bookshelf for a while, this was your sign.
As always, tonight's program is live. So whether you're with us on YouTube, Facebook, or Twitch, say hi. Let us know where in the world you're watching from. And let us know your questions for Allison, Catherine, and Kara in the chat or comments, because we'll have a Q&A after each segment where our guest will be answering your questions. And with that, we will turn it over to Allison.
Awesome. Thanks so much. Big thank you to Aria and Darian for really digging into like the deep cuts of my intertidal career. We're taking like the deep tracks here, going all the way back to my master's research that I'll be talking to you about tonight. It's been fun to revisit it though. So yeah, I'm going to be talking to you about research I did for my master's thesis at Humboldt State University, now Cal Poly Humboldt, where I was looking at the effects of temperature on mussel beds, and especially the community of species that live in and on those mussel beds. So basically, I'm going to be talking to you about mussel beds and why they're awesome. So to start off with, the intertidal, which is where mussels are, is a really stressful environment. If you're in an organism in the high intertidal, you're out of the water a lot, which means you have to be able to tolerate being out of the water a lot. You have exposure to the sun, you have exposure to hot and cold temperatures depending on the time of year. You have the wind drying you out when you're in the high intertidal. And as you move down into the low intertidal, there's a lot more organisms in the low intertidal and a ton of competition with those other organisms. There's competition for space, like to attach yourself to. There's competition for food in the low intertidal. Plus a lot of predation happens in the low intertidal as well. And so most organisms in the intertidal, in the tide pools, can only survive in like the bands that they're adapted to. And their upper limit is set by those abiotic factors, like how long they can be out of the water. And their lower limit is set by those biotic factors, like their predator might live in the lower intertidal below them. So mussels, particularly California mussels or Mussels californianus, which is the species I'm going to be talking about tonight, they live in the mid-intertidal, basically along the entire west coast of North America. And while they're in the mid-intertidal, they're actually ecosystem engineers. They create their own ecosystem through the formation of mussel beds, where the environment in the beds is markedly different from the rest of the mid-intertidal, which actually allows other species to live and survive in the mid-intertidal that normally would not be able to. So one of the other like major stresses in the intertidal, especially on the exposed coast where California mussels live, is wave action. So while there are a bunch of things that you have to deal with during low tide, during high tide, the waves crash like directly onto the tide pools. So organisms that live in the intertidal have to have ways to not get swept out into the ocean. And there's lots of different adaptations that different organisms have developed to make sure they don't get swept out into the ocean during high tide. And for mussels, this is something called Bissell threads. This is their solution. So Bissell threads, you can see in this photo here, those golden threads that are coming from that mussel. Some people call them the mussel beard. They make those threads themselves. They secrete them and they attach them basically to any hard surface around them to help them stay put basically where they are in the intertidal, which is how we get mussel beds, because not only will they attach them to rock, they will attach them to each other as well. And you can see that in this photo here, you can see some of those threads going from mussel to mussel. And so when you end up getting these mussel beds, and especially mussel beds that have been around for a while, they've been established and growing there for a while, what you find is you find mussels of all different sizes, little ones and big ones. They can sometimes be 5 or 6 mussel layers deep because the mussels will literally attach and grow on top of each other as well. And all of these mussels all together in this bed are basically creating habitat for other species. They're facilitating other species. Like I said, they're creating their own ecosystem. So those mussels basically are increasing the settlement surfaces out there. Like there's a lot of competition for hard surfaces to attach to in the intertidal. And mussel beds, like the surface of those mussel beds especially, is a lot of hard surface that that other organisms can attach to in the intertidal. And if you think down inside of those mussel beds where you have all those Bissell threads that are all attached together, you have a whole bunch of mussels down there. Basically, you can kind of think of it almost as like walking in the deep, dark forest. So those Bissell threads, they basically trap a bunch of sediment. So organisms that normally would have to live in sand and in sediment, like think of like up on the beach, they can live in mussel beds because there's a whole bunch of sediment trapped inside of those Bissell threads. Down in that mussel bed, there's reduced light penetration. So it's dark down there. It's cool and damp down there. The temperature doesn't fluctuate a lot down there as well. It kind of stays an even temperature no matter what's happening with the temperature up on the surface of the bed. And also that wave action is really reduced. Waves could be crashing on those mussel beds, but down deep inside of the bed, you can have like very little water movement happening. And also living inside of a mussel bed gets you safety from predators as well. So there have been studies that have looked at like what are the organisms and the species that live in and on mussels that are basically using mussel beds as habitat. And you can kind of think of two different ways that organisms might be using mussels. They could be living on the, like attaching to the mussels themselves. And so they're kind of a community on the surface of the bed. And they might be, or they might be living kind of down in those Bissell threads and maybe moving through the mussel bed. And so they're kind of the inside of the bed community. And so studies that have looked at these species have found like in one location, like at one site, you can find over 300 species that are living in and on mussel beds. And in a region, like just a stretch of coastline, you could find over 750 species that are living in and on mussel beds, which is just pretty amazing, the amount of diversity that they harbor. So when I was like reading about all these species and trying to think, you know, starting my graduate school program and trying to think about the research that I wanted to do, at the same time, there was this lab based out of the University of South Carolina, the Helmuth Lab, that was studying mussel bed temperatures, California mussel bed temperatures along the west coast of North America. And they were making these robo mussels, which you can see in that bed right there, basically fake plastic mussels that had a temperature sensor embedded inside of them. And they were deploying them inside of mussel beds. And what they were wanting to see is like, how hot are these mussels getting? Like basically, what are the body temperatures of these mussels? And they found, especially during summer low tides, that some of these mussels, these robo mussels, were recording temperatures that were like getting close to the thermal tolerance of mussels. Like if they stay at that temperature for too long, they start to die, which is really interesting. And what you would think is that during a low tide in the summer, mussels in Southern California must be getting hotter than mussels like way up in Washington. But the interesting thing is that when we have a good low tide along the west coast of North America, we all have a good low tide. All of us along the west coast of North America have a good low tide. But when that low tide happens is actually different. And in the summer, a good low tide in the summer happens early in the morning in Southern California, like 4 a.m., 5 a.m., 6 a.m. And on that same day with that same good low tide, that's not, that usually is happening like at around noon up in Washington. So the timing of our tides is different, even though we have good low tides. And so these mussels, they were finding these mussels up in like these farther northern latitudes that were getting much, much warmer than these mussels down in Southern California, which is really interesting, kind of these hot spots of mussels. And so I was reading this and like knowing how many species live in and on mussel beds, I started to wonder like, what do hotter mussels mean for all these species that rely on mussel beds as habitat? And so one of the things I had to figure out, kind of the best way to test this is at one site to have warmer mussels and like normal mussels or cooler mussels, so you can kind of control your variables and study the effects of having warmer mussels at one site. But like, how do you get warmer mussels in, at, you know, in a small place at one site? And I asked for a lot of advice and I got some really interesting answers, including something called the trash can of death that I'm not going to get into right now. But basically, they were all kind of like short ways to keep mussels warm. And what I needed was something that would keep mussels warmer anytime they are out of the water. I wanted my mussels to be warmer than other mussels that I was going to compare them to. And so I was trying to figure out, like, how do I do this? And so looking at mussels themselves, you know, when you look at them, they're not one color. They're actually both, there's both light and dark areas on mussel shells. So I thought, okay, what if I make basically fake mussel beds, fake mussels, and I make these fully black mussels that absorb more heat, and some fully white mussels that reflect more heat. And I can use those as my warmer and my cooler mussels. So I made molds of real mussels, all different sizes of real mussels, made molds, used this like polyester casting resin to create these fake mussels, both black and white fake mussels. I used fishing line and kind of embedded fishing line in the mussels themselves to simulate those Bissell threads that they use, because those are important for the organisms that live in the beds. I then tied all those fishing, all that fishing line to some stainless steel mesh, and then tried to secure kind of the knots of that mesh with this marine cement called Z-spar. And what I ended up creating was 10 by 10 centimeter mussel beds, 10 that were black and 10 that were white. And the plan was to deploy them in a mussel bed, like at one site, for a full year to see what the community, how the community might be different over that year. So I put them in the intertidal. I needed to find a place that was like accessible, but not too accessible so that people wouldn't bother my experiment. So I ended up deploying at this place called Elkhead, which was a little tough to get to, but it's up in Trinidad, up in Humboldt County. The marine lab is in Trinidad, so it's close to Humboldt, the Cal Poly Humboldt Marine Lab. And we deployed them, and also there was a nice big mussel bed at Elkhead. So ended up deploying them there. So here's a bunch of folks from my lab actually helping me deploy them. We had to bring down a rock boring drill so that we could drill into the rock to screw these mussel beds into the existing real mussel bed that was out there. And so installed them through this area, through this kind of large existing mussel bed. So here's what kind of what they look like. We made kind of five patches of four mussel bed each, two black and two white, and had them out in the intertidal for a year to see what would come and live on them. And you know, it wasn't perfect. Anyone who's done a thesis or a dissertation knows that there's like some crying that goes along with it, especially when you do research in the intertidal. There are huge waves and big storms that are great at destroying research projects in the intertidal. So sometimes I would come down and like look at my patch of four of my little patch of four mussel beds and see one entire bed was just entirely missing, that the waves just ripped it out. But that's why you do lots of replicates. And so in the end, I had enough beds survive throughout the year that I was able to study like what was happening with the community. So what I would do is I would go down to the site and take photographs of the surface of the beds every 3 to 4 weeks to see what was happening with that surface community. And I could analyze those photos to see what was happening with the organisms that were living on the beds themselves. And so it kind of to show you what this looked like, I deployed the beds in September of 2007. And so here's a year of photos for one bed. So here's October, November, December, January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, and then the final September. And then that September, a year later, September 2008, went down there, pulled out the screws, took out the beds, took everything that was living in the beds with them, you know, bagged them all separately and took them up to the marine lab to analyze. So I had those photos to analyze the surface of the bed. But then I also had to look at all the things that were living inside of those mussel beds as well. I ended up counting and IDing over 2,000 tiny invertebrates and organisms that were living in and on those mussel beds. Here's kind of an example of some of the things that I was finding. There were snails, there were sea spiders, there were sea stars, there were sea cucumbers, there were amphipods and isopods and chitons. So many different types of polychaetes, which is a type of marine worm. Lots and lots of different species of polychaetes. There were flatworms too. And also actually insects. That middle photo there, there were insects living inside of the beds as well. So super interesting. But I basically had to go through, count these all, and identify them all as well to understand what was happening with that inside of the community of the beds. So what did I find? So on the surface of the beds, there were kind of three main things that were growing and living on the surface of the beds. And that was barnacles, limpets, which are a type of snail, and algae were kind of the three main things I was seeing on the surface of the bed. So starting with the barnacles, interestingly, we had what we call a recruitment event sometime between March and April of 2008, which is basically when a whole bunch of little baby barnacles settle out of the water column and establish themselves in the intertidal. So you can see this one bed in March, if you look at the same bed in April, all those little tiny white dots are little tiny baby barnacles that were growing all over these mussels. And this happened with every single one of the beds I had out there. And so what I was able to do was actually track the survival for every bed. I tracked the survival of 50 individual barnacles from April all the way through September when I pulled those beds out. And I wanted to see what proportion of these barnacles were surviving on these different beds, these black beds that were warmer and these white beds that were cooler. And what I found is about 5% of the barnacles on the black beds survived, while about 18% on those white beds survived. And this could really be due to the fact that barnacle body temperatures are really influenced by their substrate. There's been studies that look at a lot of times barnacles are attached to rock, and if you have increased rock temperatures, this leads to increased mortality of barnacles. So it could be those barnacles that were settling on those black beds were experiencing higher temperatures and the higher mortality because of that. Looking at limpets, there were so many little tiny baby limpets that were living all over these mussels as well. But on average, so I had to go through all the photos and count all these little tiny baby limpets. But on average, there were about 5 times more limpets living on those white beds than the black beds. Similar to barnacles, they live in really close contact to their substrate. So it could be that limpets did not want to be on those warmer black mussels. But also limpets are herbivores. And I also had higher algae cover on white beds than black beds. And so they might have preferentially been living on those white beds because there was more food available to them on those white beds. So that was what was going on the surface of the beds. I definitely saw noticeable differences on the surface of those beds, but what was going on inside of them? So looking at all those little species that I counted inside of those mussel beds. Well, it turns out there actually wasn't a lot of difference between those black, the community inside of the black beds and the white beds. You can see that there were more gastropods, which are snails, in those white mussel beds, but that's because they had so many more limpets, which are snails. That was really influencing that number. But if you kind of just look at those colors, you can see the proportions between those black beds and the white beds are actually really similar. But this is kind of cool because we know that the surface of the beds, the surface that's exposed to the sun, definitely is heating up more than the inside of those beds. So it's really likely that the surface of those black and white mussel beds had really different temperatures, but down inside where it's cool and dark and you have all those little thistle threads, in my case, fishing line, temperatures were actually like, there wasn't a lot of fluctuation in temperature. So those beds were actually able to sustain similar communities inside. You know, and this is like really important to think about in facilitation driven systems where you have one organism that's like a primary space holder and creates habitat for other species like mussel beds, like corals, like cordgrass, for example, that these species can potentially like mitigate or dampen some of the effects of climate change for their associated species. And they could be like key factors in maintaining local species diversity, as long as the effects of climate change on that species themselves isn't like leading to increased mortality of them. So they also have to be able to survive to then help their communities to dampen the effects of their associated communities. I just want to call out really quickly before I end that there was recently, just a couple years ago, I was emailed by a woman at Cal Poly Humboldt who was basically wanting to replicate my exact same experiment. She had the same advisor. She wanted to make fake mussels and deploy them in the intertidal and look at the effects of temperature. She put them in the exact same mussel bed that I put mine in up in Elkhead. But technology has advanced so far that she didn't have to make black mussels and white mussels. She had like individual wires going to her fake mussels and heating them up to different temperatures. So it was just like, oh, that sounds like so much easier, like such a better way to control for temperature. So just amazing how far technology has advanced and like the 14, 15 years since I did my research. So with that, I want to say thank you. Happy to take questions. Thanks so much.
Oh my goodness. Thank you so much, Alison, for sharing. That was phenomenal. I can't believe I didn't know all that about your research. We can get right into questions. We have some great ones from our audience, although I would like to encourage them to continue asking such thoughtful questions. So if mussel beds provide like habitats and conditions necessary for other creatures to live in the intertidal zone, what conditions are necessary for mussels to survive and mussel beds to form?
Yeah, so especially with California mussels, they really like, they actually like wave exposure. They like kind of having a lot of water mixture going through them. They don't live as much in like harbors. There's other mussel species that you can find in like harbors and bays that like the still water, but mussels really like kind of exposed waves. So areas that get a lot of waves. And then they want to live in the mid intertidal. So an area where they're, you know, during like an okay low tide, they will be out of the water, but they're not out of the water for every single low tide. I mean, you need a kind of a decent low tide to get them out of the water. And then the main thing also is that they could probably live lower in the intertidal, but sea stars, especially ochre stars, which are the main, like kind of the primary sea star species we see on the coast here, their favorite food is mussels. And I often will go out and you can see like a perfect band of mussels and below them, all these sea stars, because sea stars like to live a little lower in the tide pools. So that really kind of constrains them to where they live. They probably could live lower, but the sea stars eat any ones that kind of make their way down into the sea star zone.
That's great. My aunt's favorite food is mussels. My aunt is a person, though. James noted that mussels also grow in freshwater, like you said. Do they grow in beds like they do in the intertidal zone when they do live in like river systems or in harbors?
You know, they can, especially a lot of non-native species that are invasive in places actually can form like in riverbeds. Like that, they tend to be, then they don't make the same kind of beds like up on rocks often that saltwater or marine mussels do, but they can actually like form beds in rivers as well. We get a whole bunch of them living together kind of like down, I mean, and like, I know the next talk is about riverbeds, but like down in the riverbed itself, you can have a whole bunch of freshwater mussels living together.
Awesome. And I know you said you weren't going to get into it. You said the phrase trash can of death. A lot of ears perked up right there. Can you give us like a little taste of what the trash can of death might be?
Yeah, I would have explained it more, but I knew I was like short on time. So I was like, let me gloss over that one. Yeah. So, when I was trying to figure out like, how do I heat up mussels in the tide pools, right? Like I need to have these warmer mussels so I can see what happens to their community. So I was emailing all these different people that study mussels like all over the West Coast of North America. And there was a researcher up at the University of British Columbia and he was like, the trash can of death. What you need to do is go down into the tide pools with like a metal trash can that you've cut a hole in the top of and you bring a blowtorch and you sit it on top of mussels and you like put the blowtorch in there for like 5 minutes. He's like, not enough to actually kill the mussels, but definitely enough to warm them up. He's like, that's my idea for how you can warm up like patch. And he literally called it the trash can of death, like how you can warm up patches of mussels that the surrounding mussels wouldn't be getting warmer. And I was like, that's an amazing idea, but I need mussels that actually like stay warm the whole time they're out of the water. Like, and I also like the site that I was like, I can't carry a giant trash can and a blowtorch down to the site that I'm putting my mussels in either. So, but it was a pretty entertaining idea that was given to me.
These people are so creative.
I know, like the amount of interesting things that get deployed in the intertidal is kind of amazing.
And one last question. I know that you mentioned that the stone boring, the metal cages you had, all these means of attachment to the rocks, some of them did not weather the rocky intertidal zone like these Bissell threads do. What makes Bissell threads so much stronger than like all of these tools that you had?
I mean, they are incredibly strong. Like, I mean, if anyone's interested, like you should go read a little thing about Bissell threads and how like people are studying them to see like, can we make materials out of Bissell threads, you know, because they have such amazing like tensile strength. One of the like kind of experiments I did when I was an undergraduate was like, we actually took individual Bissell threads and put them in a little machine that like pulled and pulled and pulled and pulled and pulled. And you could see how much tension they were under before they would finally snap. And it's like amazing how much like pulling strength they can withhold. And especially because mussels, like they put down so many Bissell threads too. It's not like they're attaching with one or two, they're attaching with like hundreds as well. So like the attachment points and the strength of those attachment points was stronger than my like rock screws and my stainless steel mesh and my fishing line for 100%. Yes.
Wild. Yeah. Every Bissell threads, everyone should be a fan. I'm such a big proponent.
Yeah. 100%. Everyone should go watch Darian's little video that he made around Bissell threads on Instagram or TikTok. Very, very entertaining and educational.
If you feel like it. Well, thank you so much, Alison, for that promo, but also for sharing your research with us. We so appreciate it. Up next, we will hear all about riverbeds and sedimentology from Catherine Russell.
Hi, everyone. I'm really excited to talk to you about my favorite thing, rivers. Yes, I drive my family around the bend with my meandering conversations. Had to get that out of the way. Okay, so we find plastic everywhere these days. It's on the tallest mountains and in the deepest ocean trenches. We even have plastic in space. So in this talk, we're going to talk about riverbeds, which is another thing that we can't see very easily. We can see the stuff on the top, but the stuff underneath all the murky waters is kind of difficult to see and also kind of difficult to study sometimes. So I'm going to show you how I did that too. But first, I'll tell you a little bit about who I am. So I actually got into geology first when I was probably about 8 years old and I started collecting rocks. I feel like many geologists have very similar stories. and I started actually doing research when I was 16, doing a school project. And I was studying these little mini fossils called graptolites, which look like kind of little sticks, and they were planktonic, we think, about 400 million years ago, quite a while ago. And I did that through Crest Award scheme. I then went to do my geology undergraduate and master's at Leicester in England. And then I went and did my PhD in fluvial sedimentology at Leeds in England. And then I went back to Leicester and was a teaching fellow in sedimentology for a few years. On my Fulbright scholarship, recently been in University of New Orleans, and I've been studying the impacts that plastic has on riverbeds and also looking at some of the sections of rivers that we do different things to, looking at dams and reservoirs as well. So one of the reasons why I love rivers so much is because they really speak to a lot of the things that we stems from their connectivity and the consequences of pollution. So we say that we can never step into the same river twice, and that's because the river is constantly replenishing itself and flowing, but each person downstream gets some of those compounded consequences of what happens upstream. And when we look at how big the Mississippi River catchment is And down in New Orleans, where I was studying, is just right down at the end of the Mississippi River. So down there, we can really feel some of those consequences, and some of the pollution levels are elevated because it's all compounded from all the different states. So I feel very passionately about all of this. And I can't talk about rivers without showing and this image as well of why I love rivers so much. They are so beautiful. I specifically study meanders and meandering systems. And my classic studies looked into how the sand and the mud gets distributed and transported down the rivers and onto the banks and the riverbeds as well. And trying to predict and understand how these rivers will change their shape over time. This is a part of the Mississippi River from the famous Fisk 1944 maps. And it's just absolutely incredible. And it shows how complicated the journey can be for one grain of sand going through the environment. So if we think about the way that sediment journeys through the environment, we can look at what we call the source to sink system. And the source to sink system, or the source sink journey, is effectively, this is very simplified for anyone who is a sedimentologist. So this is basically, we go from the mountains going, we have a grain of sand or a boulder that falls off a mountain, and it will gradually get smaller and smaller and smaller as it goes down, and it gets bits knocked off by other grains of sand, like hitting it and other pebbles. And it will travel down the river into a delta and into the ocean. So here we've got all these different sedimentary environments that are interacting with each other. So we have lakes and desert dunes as well. And this is geologically what we study. This is what we know and love as the system and the cycle. But today, I think we're on the wrong slide. Sorry, this is what we were looking at, sorry. But today we see that humans have added things to that landscape. So we have recreational activities, villages, tourism, agriculture and transport, cities, all sorts of things all across this landscape that would be once considered natural. And each of these activities will feed into what is going on within the river itself, and adding pollution and adding new materials to those landscapes. So what we find is that not only does the sediment travel down that source to sink journey, but human-made materials, not just plastic either, will also travel down that journey. There is a lot of mismanaged plastic waste in the environment, and the figures for that can vary rather dramatically, but if you're interested, it's worth looking into. And this year, Plastic Overshoot Day was the 28th of July 2023, a couple of weeks ago. And what that means is that plastic management the capacity for plastic management around the world has now been exceeded for this year. So all plastic that has been made from the 28th of July and will be made till the end of December, there's no space for it in the landfill sites, there's no space for it in recycling facilities. We are overrun by plastic, and the overshoot day comes earlier and earlier every single year. So around 80% of plastic waste that we find in the oceans and the coasts is from rivers, which is several million metric tons per year that reaches the ocean. So much of this is traveling by riverbed. So we'll get into that. Plastic consumption, as I've said, is enormous. And more than half of all the plastics ever produced have been made since 2000. And in this image on the right, the riverbed isn't even seeing sunlight anymore because of how much plastic pollution is on the surface. And it's not just what we might consider to be, we might generally consider that it's more the developing countries who have many of these plastic pollution challenges, but we also see it in the developed countries as well, including America. So Mardi Gras, it is really fun. This is a picture of me after, I think it was, I can't remember which parade it was, Pygmalion maybe. And then on the left is the Cleopatra parade for anyone that knows them all. But this is an amazing celebration that New Orleans just, it's incredible. If you've never been, you should go. But there is another side to Mardi Gras as well, which is the trash. And this is just the on the left is from Endymion, and on the right is from the Zulu parade on Mardi Gras Day. And the amount of trash is absolutely incredible. And there are so many studies and the documentaries and things on this too. And it's worth looking into if you're interested for some of the, just the vastness and the scale of it as well. But it's worth pointing out, it's really fun. This is just simply one of those consequences, right? But there's so much of it. And it's clearly a component of the landscape in all of these images. So do we consider it to be a sediment? Should plastic be considered as a sediment? And we'll come back to answering this at the end. So the way that plastic sources and roots through the environment is through us. We put it there. We created it. We do have plastic in the air that we breathe as well now with microplastics and microfibers. So some of it comes in by wind, but most of it comes from us. This map on the left is from a wastewater treatment plant, and then the two images on the right tell you more about the way that materials go in and they're transported, they're stored, they're remobilized. These are all things we see with sediment as well as with plastic. And we've got people putting it in and out, but, you know, natural processes can do that too. And the way that plastic will root, we can see it in different places in the water column too. So we can see things that float and things that will become buried. On the left here, we're looking at more macroplastics. So that's things which are over about 10 centimeters in size. And then in this image, we're seeing things that are microplastics, which is teeny tiny, normally below 5 millimeters in size. And so the things that we most associate with what we see as trash in rivers are things like polystyrene containers, floating debris, food packaging, that sort of thing, right? Because it floats. But on the riverbed, you know, we don't know what's down there. And it's to do with the density and the materials that things are made of. But it's very difficult to sample and to see it. So this is what I did. So this is the one of the images from the study. We're just looking at plastic in the sediment. So when we're looking at river, so in a sandy riverbed, we see river dunes. And these happen because we have, in this image, we've got flow direction from the right to the left. We have a stoss side, which is the upstream side of it, which then, so the flow will go over that to the lee side, and we get what's called a recirculation zone, which we'll see with a couple of plastic pieces. And over time, repeated erosion and deposition causes this dune to migrate downstream, and it does so at a steady rate, and it feeds downstream with sediment at a steady rate, and it helps with the management of nutrition for ecosystems downstream. So what happens when we add plastic? So to do this experiment, you can see all the little dunes up there in the top of the in the flume tank. So we put some sand into the flume tank, we put some water in as well, and we got it flowing. And what these are is effectively rivers that are kind of mechanical that we can study, we can put things into. They're glass-sided bathtubs in a way that have a flow going through. So it's a fake river. It's a thing that we can study. So we had it running at about 0.5 meters per second. And the amount of plastic that I put in was about 0.12% by mass. So this really isn't a lot. And the plastics that I put in, put some Mardi Gras beads in, some pieces of fabric, and then other things like pony beads, filter tips, and just some little plastic fragments and things like that. So a range of different things. So on the lee side, this is the downstream, slightly steeper side, we see that we can bury individual particles like this. And then we can get these larger groups as well, which will get buried. And the reason this happens is because the sand is constantly migrating. We're still getting that erosion on the stoss side of the dune as it's moving downstream. And the dune is constantly moving forward because the river doesn't stop flowing. It keeps going. And so we get these burials. And those are the higher density particles. Now, the lower density particles are much more difficult to bury. And if we just watch this lower layer here, and we watch that this upper section is taking that turbulence of what we saw in the in that flow recirculation zone there, these are picking up on that turbulence and they're protecting this lower layer so it can get deposited, and it does, and it gets buried. So to summarize the lee side processes, what we see is this multi-layered deposition of the lower density particles. And that can end up with a lens as a group deposit, or we can get these individual particles as well. On the stuff side, we see erosion of particles. So we see this as a really nice shaped dune. This is your classic style. And then just there, we see a filter tip zoom off, and it leaves this scour. And that scour causes the dune to need to readjust. And because it's readjusting, it's having to move its sediment around. The physics is trying to sort itself out. It's trying to make it so that it's stable again within this flow, because there's just been a massive part of its structure that has disappeared. And see, it's now flatter. So what we end up with is dune shapes, which have a more rounded crest, lower height, lower sand volume, and more sand in suspension, which we don't know what that all means yet. And so we've just seen the individual clast erosion. So now we'll look at group erosion. So these are two clips compounded together. The first is from the back of the dune. Second clip is from the front. Just a few seconds apart, just time it took me to walk around to the front part. And you'll see that you can see now that we've got all these little particles jumping out. And this is partly because they're really smooth. So as soon as you get a little bit of that surface exposed, the whole lot gets exposed, because there's no friction for the sand to stick to, because the surface of the plastic is so smooth. It's also because as soon as it's exposed, it's physically bigger than the sand. And so it causes scouring. The turbulence around it causes it to scour. And then once there's enough scour, then the buoyancy of that particle is much higher because the density is lower, and it will just zip out of there and carry on in the flow. So you can see that we're getting all of these little particles causing this dip. Now we're at the front of the same dune, and you can see this stossite slope coming in here. So we're still depositing material. We're still capturing plastics here at the lee side, but we've got this shape in June, which is severely decreasing, so it's severely like sloping and coming in. So we are definitely seeing some physical changes to the riverbed because of the way the plastic is interfering. So this can lead to dunes being completely removed from the riverbed, and this is called dune washout. So when we have washout due to an individual clast, we've seen this, and you can get the dune kind of flattening off, or you know, stabilizing again. And even with a group washout, you can get the dune restabilizing again, but we end up with these remnants at the bottom of like pieces of plastic. And so what we find is that we get these little groups. I've dotted around them in white, and you can see that we've got this very heterogeneic distribution of the way that the plastic is within the riverbeds. And if we were to imagine this really scaled up, and we just pop a grabber down here to pick up what's on the riverbed, we might not actually be reaching the full extent of how much plastic is down there, which unfortunately makes me really think that we have been quite underestimating how much plastic is, in fact, in our riverbeds. But what we found is that plastic is not a passive component, and we need to be studying it more. Plastic inclusion changes the ratio of suspended load to bed load material, and the inclusion of plastics encourages rivers to develop more conduit-like compared to storage. So conduit is the passage through, and storage is the storage of, and create these heterogeneic deposits. So we find that we need a new subdiscipline of sedimentology, which is plastic and sediment interactions. And we don't yet understand the potential long-term or large-scale consequences of physical pollutants in our environment. So we ask, is plastic a sediment? It travels the source to sink route. It is subject to the same natural forces that affect sediment. Its physical properties affect its behavior and distribution, all like sediment, but it's not natural. But then does it become existential? Because these plastics are in rivers, and can we consider our rivers to be natural anymore? We manage over half of the world's natural fresh water. And in the early to mid 1970s, sea level didn't rise for a couple of years because of how much fresh water was being held back on land in all of the dams that were being built around the world. We don't just have geology, geomorphology, physics, geography, and biology feeding into river systems anymore. We have safety, conservation, law, trade, economics, politics, climate change, all things that we have contributed to that is fundamentally changing everything. But that's a whole other story and talk. So it's not natural, but is this a reason? What do you think? My view on this is plastic is a sediment, and this is a link to a preprint which goes into how we can classify plastic as a sediment and really start to understand how we can quantify this new material by its physical properties that is clearly globally distributed. But that's all from me. So thank you very much.
Hey, Catherine, that was, I feel like one of our viewers put it best. Wow, this is so interesting, terrifying, but fascinating. Which
terrifying, but fascinating, yes. I'll take that.
Absolutely, yeah. One other note that another viewer, Thomas, has awarded you an honorary PhD in punology for that first slide of yours, so bestowed upon you. We'll get right into questions because we have many great ones, and audience friends, please keep asking them. James asks, do plastics erode and change as they travel through these river systems in the roles of sediments?
Oh, that's a very fascinating and deep question. Yes, they do. And they do so in such an incredible and strange way. Like with sediment, we don't have to think about color very much, for example. But what we find is that they, of course, become bleached. And some of that bleaching is simply because of bleaching. And some of it is to do with the removal of the plasticizer. So we end up with anything that's kind of elasticated with UV light can become very brittle very quickly. And so they can not only change their color, but their size, because they get abraded down in just the same way as sediment. But also they change their properties, like physical properties as well. So they are incredibly complicated and dynamic. And there are probably about 200 PhDs in deciding the answer to that question.
So James, you know what you're going to go do. Go tackle one of those.
There are many chemists who are doing some phenomenal work in that.
Oh, amazing. That's great. And just on dune shapes and how they impact the river, can you tell us more about that? Like, you mentioned that dune shapes are changing because of these plastics, but why is that important?
Yeah, so the extent to which this is important, we really don't know yet. So this study was done in 2019, but I've since done some follow-up work with Mardi Gras beads in New Orleans, because it was quite fitting. So we did some experiments there, and we're really at the fundamentals still of what percentage of plastic in the bed actually is where we start to see an impact. And the numbers are really scary low. And we don't really know what the full extent of this is going to be. It increases the amount of, you know, change within there. Does it increase the scour and things? We'll have to watch this. I haven't started analyzing it. I have the data on here. So we'll find out one day when I finish analyzing it. But yeah, there is a lot to learn and many angles of study.
Yeah, absolutely. So Erica asks, how does plastic end up in rivers, and what are the most, I mean, besides Mardi Gras, of course, like you mentioned, but what are the most effective ways that we can keep plastic out of waterways moving forward?
So it depends on where you live, because there are so many different impacting factors in different areas. I know that one thing that we tend to not think about too much is microfibers, and much of what we are wearing is, you know, goes through the washing machine, and microfibers actually go into the washing machine. And one of the slides I showed was from wastewater treatment plants. So we actually have an awful lot of plastics that come out of wastewater treatment plants, which is from washing machines and from clothing. So you can actually wash your clothes in like a guppy bag, or you can add a filter into your washing machine, and that can have a pretty profound impact. I was shocked by how much microfiber came out first time I did that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I'm pulling out the lint filter, but with microplastics, like the...
It is so different. It does depend on where you live. And it might be, you know, there might be a study for where you live that shows you the kinds of things and things you can do to have the biggest impact.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And one final question. Rock collection. I was also a rock collecting kid. Do you still have rocks from your early days of collecting?
I have. Well, here's some sand on my desk. I do still have rocks. Yes, I have. I have my little suitcase of rocks that I used to keep in my cupboard when I was a kid. And my parents finally decided about 5 years ago, when I moved out, that it was time I had my rock collection back, and they were very relieved to stop worrying about the ceiling. So I have that somewhere in the attic, but
yeah, you just have so many, it weighs it down. Amazing.
You can never have too many rocks.
Yeah, a I'm so sorry. Yeah, true. So true. Well, thank you so much for being here tonight and at such an interesting time for you. We really, really appreciate you being here and sharing.
Thank you for having me. It's wonderful to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. And next up, we'll bring Kara.
Hello. Am I here? There I am. Oh, sorry. My technology situation is a little silly, but here we go. So I'm really excited tonight to be talking to you about my cross-stitch maps, especially my bedrock geology and how I've used cross-stitch in particular and fiber arts and art more generally to connect to my environment and some of the awesome science that I've learned about, similar to the last couple talks we've heard about mussel beds and river sedimentology. I find that it's, watching these kinds of programs through places like California Academy of Sciences or going to conferences when I was in grad school or all these different things, there's always so much fascinating information, and I have a hard time you can only ever process or really connect to a pretty small proportion of what's there. So I've been using art to make at least the pieces of all this fascinating information we have about our world feel a little bit more like my own, and to feel like I understand it and connect to it better. So first, hopefully, there we go. I'm just have this one slide just to give us a little bit of perspective on how long fiber art and embroidery has been important around human cultures around the world. So this is one example of an embroidery telling telling history, or maybe propaganda, depending on your perspective, of the people who commissioned it. But this is, you know, a 224 foot long embroidery that tells a bunch of stories about the Norman conquest of England. So you can think about all the people. Like, this took, I believe, years to make, definitely dozens of people. And this is just one way that fiber art has been used in one culture. So there are tons of different kind of ways that we use fiber art to express ourselves, to express our cultures, to record information, and to explore. So what I do is cross-stitch, which is, I would call it, embroidery on easy mode. So it's basically, it uses this specialized fabric called Aida that has kind of gridded holes in it, as you can see on the left here. And so you can make patterns that are very reproducible, or exactly reproducible. So I find a lot of I do some embroidery more freehand myself, which I think can be very beautiful, especially other artists take it to a very high level. But I like cross-stitch because you can make such exact patterns, so that I can take patterns from other people, or other people can use my patterns to interact with the information that I've translated into cross-stitch. And now I'm going to take this opportunity, talking about my bedrock geology patterns, to tell you a little bit about Iowa, which is my home state and where I'm living again now, and a little bit about the geologic history that I've connected to through this art form. So a lot of Iowa was, for a lot of its geologic history that's preserved in bedrock, was an inland sea. So this is from the Iowa Museum of Natural History in Iowa City. This diorama thing that they have that I love. So this represents one big chunk of our history. At other times, we were a swamp, so still wet and with sediments being deposited. So from things like the Devonian era, we have a lot of limestone. And then I included a slide of Rusty, who's a giant sloth, and he is not relevant to the geologic times that I'm capturing in my maps, but I felt he was important to include since I was taking images from the Museum of Natural History. Another thing, one of the coolest features of Iowa, I think, is something called the Manson Impact Structure, which I'm going to talk about just very briefly. Let's see. So I'll show you. It's this yellow circle on the left on this slide, and it's marked with a black circle in my patterns. But this was formed during an impact in the Cretaceous period, and it was believed for a while to be potentially responsible for the KT boundary extinction event. It was studied and found that it's actually not big enough, and it's off by something, I think, like 12 million years. So Iowa does not have the crater from an impact that killed the dinosaurs. But for a little while, it was thought that we might, I think in the 90s. So this covers a large portion of one county, a couple different counties. It impacts, you can see where in the formation of this crater, you know, a meteor asteroid hit, and which pushes down the ground, and then very quickly all that force comes back up, and you end up with kind of this peak in the middle, and then it's a just very like shattered and broken up layers of sediment on top to either side. So, you know, this impact, I have some friends that live in Manson, Iowa, where this gets its name, and it impacts the water quality pretty profoundly. They have to treat the water much more carefully because there's so much, the bedrock is so much, it's very close to the surface for Iowa, and so broken up that chemicals can leach out of the rock much more easily, and they have to keep track of that. So yes, that's a fun thing about Iowa that I enjoy stitching onto my map. So you can see this is a map from the Iowa Geological Survey. So that first diorama I showed you from the Museum of Natural History was Devonian, which is this kind of middle lavender color and this lighter blue color here. So that's where exposed for Iowa, it's under a bunch of glacial till, but our bedrock is from the Devonian era when we were a shallow inland sea. And then other eras like Pennsylvanian, which is, I believe, when our coal swamp days, that we have a bunch of southern Iowa, the exposed bedrock is from that era. And yeah, it's fun. I like cross stitch because it can be pretty meditative, but I also, obviously, we can connect to, I like connecting and thinking about all the different, you know, the different places I've lived in Iowa with regards to this map and what bedrock or what other features I was living over. So I was trying to think of how to describe my process for making these in an interesting way, because I think they're such interesting subject matter. But the method I have found most successful is kind of relatively low tech. I use cross-stitch design software, and I import in the outline of whatever state or lake or other map I'm looking at. It's important to, well, what I discovered working with cross-stitch, our standard cross-stitch fabric is 14 count, which means those little gridded holes in the fabric, there are 14 of them in an inch, which ends up meaning that my maps stitched on standard cross-stitch fabric have 14 pixels per inch, which is extremely low resolution. So I've tried importing in maps, various types of maps, to make these patterns, and I found that I just end up with a mess. So I currently just import in the boundary or the outline of whatever map I'm creating, and then use my reference map and my interpretation to draw in my map pixel by pixel, essentially. And you know, there's a fill function, so but you do end up stitching every single one, which I enjoy. And so yeah, this is my relatively, and I started with Iowa because it's my home state, and I was asked by a friend who has geologist family members who wanted this as a gift for them. And Iowa is challenging enough, but compared to some other states, and I have made map patterns for all the US states and Guam and Puerto Rico. I wanted to do all the populated territories as well, but couldn't find very good reference geology maps. Anyway, so some of the states are not nearly as friendly to my project as Iowa is. Like, you all over on the West Coast have a lot of really interesting stuff going on that is extremely difficult to translate to 14 pixels per inch. So states like Washington and California, I have a bit later on, it took, since I did still draw in these maps, because just importing this in just kind of makes a colorful blob mess. I had to work on it for a while until I felt like my vision started to blur, and since set it aside for a few days or a week. But it's extremely cool. I love being able to work with, yeah, I love being able to connect this, and this piece, I maybe stitched this twice, but definitely this one in the photo belongs to a geology friend who lives in Washington now. So for the rest of my slides, almost all the rest of my slides, I just have a bunch of the pictures of the state geology maps that I've stitched so far. So I'm just going to talk through a little bit some of the decisions you have to make in making maps, because even if you're not trying to make maps on a scale of 14 pixels per inch, you're always approximating, you're always making decisions and leaving something out when you're making a map. So I don't know, you can see it's hard to read my my legends, but like here, the geology of Puerto Rico is all much younger than, like, for example, the geology of Arizona. So they both have the Cretaceous era rocks of whatever type, because I do most of my maps by geologic time. Occasionally I do it by rock type, depending on the maps that I'm able to find. We'll talk about that in a moment. But anyway, so both of these have the Cretaceous in green, and then most of Arizona is older than that, with just the yellow being younger, and all of the rest of these ages for Puerto Rico would be collapsed into the Cenozoic era on this, on the Arizona map, if that makes sense. So the, I broke up the newer geology of Puerto Rico into four categories, whereas in Arizona it's collapsed into one, but you could also break it up. You just have to decide what's the most meaningful and interesting. Like, are there enough rocks of different ages for it for you need to include them? And is one pixel of a different age interesting enough to separate out? Because, like, sometimes, but not always. Let's see. Yeah. So again, we just heard a talk from research partially in Louisiana, down in New Orleans. So my map of Louisiana also has a lot of more recent eras, or not eras, but categories of geologic time broken up because it is much more recent sedimentary bedrock. Yeah, so I'm gonna flip through, see Montana also. It's very difficult, didn't cooperate with my project. So I'm just gonna flip through the rest of these. Oh, Arizona, twice. Okay, and then I threw in at the end, since we were also talking about beds in general, I think that bathymetry, or the depth maps of lakes, make gorgeous maps and gorgeous fiber art. And to end, I wanted to just invite everyone watching this to try and pick a fact or a concept or a map or a figure that you would like to connect to, that spoke to you, or you'd like to understand more, either from the other talks at Night School or that you encounter elsewhere in the world, and try and connect with it more through art. Whether that means just doodling for yourself, which is an excellent way to express things. I like to print out black and white maps just from Google Maps and draw on them. And those are never worth, they're not made to share, they're not pretty, but it's a way to connect with what's in my environment or a place that I want to learn about. And if you have any other existing hobbies, maybe there's a way that you can translate some of our cool science into that. And I think it's really important. I'm not in academia anymore, but especially in academia, I think it's also important to remember that the human brain does the best with information in kind of a mode of play, from my understanding. So it's important to, if it's possible for you, find ways to have fun with anything that you want to learn about. Okay, and then this is my just end of places you can find me, and I'd be happy to take some questions.
Thank you so much, Kara, for one, that amazing presentation, but especially that final slide. We here at Night School love it when the creative arts and sciences intersect. And so we're so excited that you're here sharing with us and encouraging our audience to do the same.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Our first question is kind of a chicken and the egg situation. Which came first, your love of geology or bedrock geology or fiber arts?
Yeah, I guess that is kind of I definitely learned, my grandmother taught me to cross stitch when I was in elementary school, and then I didn't pick it back up again until after I had a master's degree in earth and environmental sciences. So I learned cross stitch first, but they met in my mind after I liked both of them. So
it's always a little bit of both.
Yes, absolutely.
Marcia asks, do you have any other kind of aspects of science and nature that you hope to explore through cross-stitch, other than bedrock geology and bathymetry? What's next, or is there?
Yes. So I've done watershed maps for the US states. I haven't actually stitched as many of them, but I have the patterns. And I've designed some ecoregion patterns. I've done some other things as well. Right now, I've been trying to do native prairies and native Iowa flower species and plant species. But yeah, I get like, there are so many extremely cool things about the world that also look extremely cool visually. So I have a lot of lists of ideas, and I will not live long enough to get to all of them, but yeah.
It's great to have a wealth of ideas. That's kind of an amazing place to be. which takes longer for you, the actual designing of the patterns or the cross-stitching itself?
That is a good question. And for the maps, it probably usually takes a bit longer to design the pattern. Yeah, but but it's hard to, that is a good question and not one, I'm not good at keeping track of time for how long things have taken me. So definitely in terms of like, from like the date of the start date to the end date, it takes longer for me to design because I often have to step away because I feel like I can't see the difference. Like I can't tell what kind of, yeah, I just can't see it. I like can't look at it meaningfully anymore. And I have to step away, do something else. Whereas cross-stitching, it can be something I can do for long periods of time, but I don't know if I have a good answer for that.
Yeah, no, it's insightful. Do you know, so you labeled a bunch of these patches of bedrock as like belonging to the Devonian or Pennsylvanian or any type of geological period. What happens in those periods that like, is the bedrock created in those periods or just exposed in those periods?
Right, it is created in those periods is what gets that label. But yeah, as far as the actual geologic history of an area, like the story of when it gets exposed and how you end up, like if it was just a matter of sediment being laid down and then being exposed again, all of these flat places like Iowa would just be one geologic era. So it also at some point shifts, you know, like moves in different ways and things get deposited. So geology is cool and I know a little bit about it, but yes.
Oh, it's such a massive field. Yeah. And then our final question, do you have any tips for beginner cross-stitching hopefuls?
Yeah. So I guess my main tip for what I can add to someone is to remember that cross-stitch, like I think that cross-stitch is relatively easy. Like it is relatively straightforward and simple, but my main tip is to remember that anytime you learn a new thing, it will take time. Like your brain has to build new connections. And, you know, if you, as you start practicing any new skill, when you look back at your first pieces in a few months or a year, you'll realize you've gotten a lot better. So if the first thing you stitch will probably be relatively a mess, right? And that means you're doing it right.
That's an excellent reminder.
That's my main thing. I like, and for other tips, there are like great videos, which was very, it's kind of going through a renewed popularity right now, but it was also very popular in like the 70s and 80s. So a lot of public libraries have a bunch of cross-stitch books that have like, if you're someone who likes to look at things on paper, there are a lot of cross-stitch books probably at your library with instructions, which I like as well.
Libraries are amazing resources. Oh, I had no idea. Well, thank you so much for sharing. It looks like a lot of people in our audience have been inspired in their own ways to to engage with the sciences through art. And that's really exciting to me. So I'm so glad that you were here
Absolutely.
Tonight. Thank you so much. I'm gonna bring Aria back on screen. Hello. Thank you so much to Alison, Catherine, and Kara for a night that, despite being all about beds, was like truly the furthest thing imaginable from a snooze fest.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. And we here on Night School are live on the third Thursday of every month, which means that we will be back on the 21st night of September for Night School Earth, Wind, and Fire. Where we'll be diving into all kinds of natural disasters, whether earthquakes or tornadoes or wildfires, from a very safe distance. And I'm not a singer, so don't come for me. Just felt like I had to.
We're so pleased with that title. Until then, you should definitely subscribe to the California Academy of Sciences YouTube channel. If you do, you'll be notified every time that we are in session. There, you can also rewatch all past episodes of Night School, including this one, for free, anytime, anywhere. I'd tell you to watch some old episodes as you go to bed, but the program's too interesting. It'll keep you up.
Mm-hmm. But if you would like, here is the QR code that we mentioned a little bit earlier in the program, and there's a link that's going into the chat with a survey that'll help us to continue making Night School with you, our viewers, in mind. And with that, I do think it is bedtime for us here on the West Coast, of the sleeping variety.
Yeah. Oh, I agree.
Yawn. But thank you, everyone, for joining us again. Take care. Have a great night.
Good night.